If you have your Bibles with you this morning, we ask you to turn to the book of 2 Samuel chapter 23, and we'll begin reading in the very first verse. 2 Samuel chapter 23, in the first verse, the Bible says, "Now these be the last words of David. David the son of Jesse said, and the man who was raised up on high, the anointed of God, of the God of Jacob, and the sweet psalmist of Israel said, the Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his word was in my tongue. The God of Israel said, the Rock of Israel spake to me, he ruleth over men, he that ruleth over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God. And he shall be as the light of the morning, when the sun riseth, even a morning without clouds, as the tender grass springeth out of the earth by clear shining after the rain. Although my house be not so with God, yet he hath made me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and sure. For this is all my salvation and all my desire, although he make it not to grow. But the sons of Belial shall be all of them as thorns thrust away, because they cannot be taken with hands. But the man that shall touch them must be fenced with iron, and the staff of the spear, and they shall be utterly burned with fire in the same place. These be the names of the mighty men whom David had. The Tachmonite that sat in the seat, chief among the captains, whose name was Adino the Ezanite. He lifted up his spear against 800, whom he slew at one time. And after him was Eleazar, the son of Dodu, the Ammonite, one of the three mighty men with David, when they defied the Philistines that were gathered together to battle, and the men of Israel were gone away. He arose and smote the Philistine until his hands were weary and his hand clave into the sword. And the Lord wrought a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to spoil. And after him was Shema, the son of Agivi, the Haranite. And the Philistines were gathered together in a troop with a piece of ground full of lentils, and the people fled from the Philistines. But he stood in the midst of the ground and defended it and slew the Philistines, and the Lord wrought a great victory." Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. Lord, we praise you for all the things that you do this morning. We praise you, and we would wish to lift you up this morning above all things, Lord, that you would be visible and that you would be seen in this place. Lord, help us as a needy people, Lord God, that we might learn from your word, that it might touch our hearts as never before, Lord. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, we'll be preaching this morning on the thought of serving God to the fullest. Serving him to your absolute best ability. Doing everything that you possibly could do for the cause of Christ. Now, as we begin this, I'll say this, no one can do that all the time, but everyone can do it some of the time. And you'll find these in samples that were given here, that's exactly what these men did. Now, I want you to see, first of all, in the first verse there, that this was David's final public address. He did live a while after this. He lived long enough to anoint Solomon to be king in his stead. But this was the last thing that he said to national Israel. And I've often wondered, when will be the time, the last time that you address people publicly? And you say, well, I don't preach. I never address people publicly. Yes, you do.
Amen.
Yes, you do. You address people publicly every day on the workplace. You address people publicly every day in the grocery line. You address people publicly, routinely, even if we won't acknowledge it that way. I want you to see that he's acknowledged for who he was in the line and in the lineage. David was the son of Jesse. David, the son of Jesse, said, "The man who was raised up on high, the anointed God of the anointed God of Jacob, and the sweet psalmist of Israel said." Now, I want you to see in that verse, he is credentialed only by the merit of God. You know, if you do something on behalf of the Lord, you acknowledge him and do not ever acknowledge yourself. See, David was who he was by the hand of God and nothing else. If you remember when he was selected and anointed, Samuel had to say, "Do you yet have any other sons?" Because he went through them in birth order and did not find the right one. And they had David out there tending the sheep, doing a very routine chore, and he was the one that's anointed. Now, many people today are highly used of the Lord just because they're willing and nothing more. Verse 3, the Bible says, "The God of Israel said, the rock of Israel spake to me, he that ruleth over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God." Now, you can go into a whole lot of that, and you might even think about President Trump, but listen, what this was saying, in addition to being a national leader, you need a pastor that will preach the truth. You need a pastor that will not tell you how good you are and how you've arrived in good Baptist doctrine, but will preach to you, "We still stand today as a very, very needy people. We stand as a people that need to hear from God on at least a weekly basis. That's what we need to hear as the Lord's people." And the reason it's not popular preaching, we don't like to perceive ourselves as needy. We like to perceive ourselves that we're pretty self-independent. We like to perceive ourselves that we're doing pretty good, but that is not the case. Now I want you to see in verse 4, it says, "And he," meaning that ruler, "and he shall be the light of the morning when the sun riseth, even a morning without clouds, as the tender grass springeth out of the earth by clear shining after the rain." Now, whether an individual who's a leader likes it or not, they are very visible. We should be a visible people. We should be a people that is easily identifiable in a crowd, that the light rests upon. You know what? If we look like the world and we present like the world, you're not going to shine out. You're going to blend right in with the rest of the crowd. You're going to look like the rest of the crowd. You're going to talk like the rest of the crowd. And nobody will even know that you're a believer of Christ. I fully believe that is the base of modest dress for both men and women. It's because we're worse to death. And men's no different than women. Listen, we don't need britches cut off up here. I'll say this, we don't even need them cut off up here. They need to go as long as mine is this morning. And that's no different than applying, you know, you hear a lot on women's dress, and well, we should, but you don't hear very much on men's dress. You know what? Your sleeves need to come down here. You don't need to expose your body. You need a collar that comes up and makes you a well-covered individual. We ought to strive to stick out like a sore thumb. Now, with that said, he says, listen, they're going to be looking at you. Verse 5, David makes a confession. "Although my house is not so with God." He knew there were problems. He knew about Absalom. He knew that he had messed up in parenting. He knew that he had let idolatry slip in. He knew that about the sexual sins between one of his daughters and her half brother. He knew about that. That was if you follow that out, that was Absalom's full sister. And there were people that died because of it.
Yeah.
So he knew he had messed up parenting. He knew that he had not done a good job. And you know, the sad thing is his life was approaching its end. He also knew now it was too late to do anything about it. You know, you have about 14 years to impact your children's life and make them and mold them, and then it's over. By the time a person's 12 or 14, they are who they are. Now, I understand Christ can intervene and He can save their soul, but I have met plenty of people that had a smart mouth and appeared to be saved. If you don't knock that smart mouth out of them while they're young, they'll keep it. See, it's a time of molding. It's a time of putting them where they need to be. And so we see that David, sadly enough, realized he had blown it as a father. And he was upset at it. He was grieving over it, although now he could not. Now, verse 6, as a result of that, "But the sons of Belial shall be all of them as thorns thrust away, because they cannot be taken with hands." Now, I'll say this. He knew that the sons of Belial, those idolatrous people, and if you want to find Belial still around and well today, when you leave Dover, turn to your right, and across from the county cemetery is a temple of Belial. You say, "Well, what is that?" That's a lodge. Uh-oh. Mm-hmm. But that's what it is.
Yeah.
That's exactly what it is. And so we see, he says, "Listen, we'll never win this battle." But that's no reason not to fight it. You know what? Even in the day which we live today, sin overruling our land, that's no excuse for you not to do anything. That's no excuse for you to sit on your backside and do nothing.
Right. Yeah.
And sometimes we want to say, "Well, it's all over. We're living in the last day. Boo-hoo. Let's just stop doing anything." But you know what? The Bible does not back that up, nor will it ever back it up, because we are to be an active people. "But the sons of Belial shall be all of them as thorns thrust away, because they cannot be taken with hands. But the man that shall touch them must be fenced with iron, the staff of a spear. They shall be utterly burned with fire in the same place." Now, he gave them some battle directions. He gave them some ways to approach the battle. And he says, you need to approach it with your iron on. You know what? Most believers today don't have their iron on. And most of them have never even had it to start with. And the iron that you need is the truth of the Word of God. You need to be taught something. Listen, if you have a question concerning any of life's aspects, ask someone who's a believer. Ask someone that's been in that book. Ask somebody that studied it out. And listen, there is truth. There's not one instance that will come up in your life that there's not some truth to apply to it. That there's some biblical truth that you can say, "Okay, this is what has worked before. This is what I need to do." And so it says, put your iron on. Be sure that you have yourself protected as you go forth. Now, if you see, he says, go and you burn these briars before you. Burn the thorns and get them out of your way. You approach it with iron so it can't be, can't prick you. And then you set them on fire. Now, today, that's one thing we don't like to do. Fire has always been a purifier. It purifies things. You know, the hardest thing you'll ever do is tell someone you love that they're wrong. That's the hardest thing you'll ever do.
Amen.
And you need to do that. You know, as sad as this all sounds, we all can't be right, can we? Camelot people, they preach a gospel, but as sad as it sounds, they can't be right. Pentecostal people preach a Christ. But you know what? They can't be right. And so we as the Lord's people, when we approach these things, certainly we must have our armor on, and we must have the insight and the strength to say, hey, this briar patch is a mess, and I'm going to set it on fire. I'm going to get it out of the way. Verse 8, it takes different kinds of men to do that. The average believer and the average Christian will not get this job done. It takes somebody with a little bit more oomph. It takes somebody with a little bit more strength. And takes someone a little bit more willingness to be yielded to the Lord. Now, these three mighty men stood alone. All by themselves. Those of you that were in Adam's class for that time we studied the life of David, I think it took about a year. You ought to be able to knock off those mighty men just like that. 1, 2, 3. Now, as I was reviewing for this sermon, I didn't get them all. So everybody start naming. But they were mighty men. But if you think about the expanse of who they were, the size of the nation of Israel, and even the size of David's army, three wasn't that good. It wasn't that many to be called a mighty man. But they were. These be the names of the mighty men whom David had. The Tachmonite that sat in the sea among the chief of the captains. The same was Adino, the Eznite. He left up his spear against 800. Whom he slew at one time. That's getting rid of the brush. That's getting rid of the briars. Now, you think about yourself put in a situation against 800. What would most of us do? Tuck tail and run, right?
Yeah.
Tuck tail and run. But now, whether you want to accept it or not, you're probably put in that situation almost every day. Mm-hmm. Now, when I have my students at the hospital, visitors, patients, and staff members, there's at least easily 800 people in that building every day. Right? So am I going to present them the truth, or am I going to give them a little musical story? Am I going to say you're hopeless without the intervention of God, or am I going to say you do what you want to, you approach God on your terms, and everything's going to work out just fine? How will I approach them? You know, Oprah Winfrey is the biggest devil, one of the biggest devils in media you will ever find. You know, she started out at a Baptist church down here in Nashville. That's she was born and raised in Nashville. And she went to an independent Baptist church because all dark-skinned churches have nothing to do with the association. So in that sense, they are very akin to what we do. She made the blasphemous statement that she was sitting in church one day and it was revealed to her that that can't be the only way. Now, it may have been revealed to her, but it didn't come from God.
Amen.
Amen.
Right.
That's, you know what? For everything God has, the devil has counterfeit. Mm-hmm. And the Holy Ghost can be mimicked. Be very cautious of that. Be very cautious of that. And so we see then, as this event is transpiring, that this wasn't the type of man to give up. He wasn't the type to be trumped simply by numbers. Verse 9, and after him was Eleazar, the son of Dodu, the Ahonite, one of the three mighty men with David, when they defiled the Philistines, they were gathered together to battle. And the men of Israel were gone away. Now, read your text. It says the men of Israel were gone away. Now, to have said they were gone away, it means they were there at one time, or it would have had to say the men of Israel wasn't there, right? It said they were gone away. That they were there and now they're gone. And you know what? I have had a very short ministry, relatively speaking. I've been trying to preach the Word of God for about 23 years. And I've seen a lot of people come and go. A lot of people that was committed. Oh yes, being separate is important. Sticking to the doctrinal truth is very important. The beliefs of the church is extremely, extremely important. And they all threw it in the garbage can. And now they're ecumenical. And if somebody comes into that back door wearing tight breeches, they're like, "Woo! I'm so glad to see you." They throw it away. So you know what that tells me? Someday, or some days, different occasions, I could be standing by myself too. You could be standing by yourself also. Right?
Right.
And so, because of the heat of the battle, and because the odds did not look good, we found that that Eleazar stood alone. Now, most of us, when we stand alone, we tend to be quiet. There's a few of us that might stand and say, "Okay, I'm going to stick it out," but they're not very verbal about it. They're not very strong in what they have to say. They just kind of sit there. You know what you do when you stand there against that many people? All you are is a target. All you are is something that they can shoot at. So what did he do? He arose and smote the Philistine until his hand was weary and his hand clave unto the sword. Now I have looked at that and I have preached it at different times. Number one, I see two things in this. One, I once thought that his hand got locked. Because he had held so long. But I don't believe that anymore. It said that he did it till his hand was weak. He was striking, and got tired, his hand was hurting, but he still clave on. He still held to it. So he would not let it go. And there are days and there are times where you just can't let it go. You do not need to be a compromiser here in the last days. You do not need to be one to say, "Well, I guess one is just about as good as the other." You don't need to be the type in the end time to say, "Hey, whatever you believe is just fine." We do not need to be those type of people. But we need to be those type of people that don't turn loose of the sword. And you'll have days you are so weak that you're like, "Just forget it, I'm done. I cannot do this anymore." And if you've never had that experience, you're probably not doing much to start with. And so we see that as the Lord's people, certainly we have to contend on. We have to keep going. We have to keep fighting. And that's exactly what Eleazar, that was the type of individual he was. Verse 11, after him was Shema, the son of Agi, the Hararite, and the Philistines were gathered together into a troop. So we had three men, but only two enemies. We see the group that the first man fought, and then we found that the second two men fought the same group, fought the same individuals. Now, many times you're going to have to go around and go back different individual to the very same people. You know what? Should the Lord not return in my lifetime, one day you'll bury me in this lot out here beside the church. And some of you that are left behind are going to have to fight the exact same battles that I've already fought. The exact same enemies will be there. You'll be a new generation, they'll be a new generation, and there'll be new battles to fight. And so when that time comes, you need to stand to the stuff. And that's really what was occurring here. The very same individuals had rose up in rebellion against God. Now notice this man. It did not seem like he was fighting for much. And after him was Shema, the son of Agi, the Harorite, and the Philistines stood gathered together into a troop, where was a piece of ground full of lentils, and the people fled from the Philistines. Now, does anybody know what lentils are? They're beans, or peas. Dried on the vine, just like the kind of beans that we cook when we get them out of the sack and put them in. That's a type of a lentil. Now, apparently these were ready to harvest because they were identified as lentils. You know what those men that fled felt like? It's not worth fighting for. Just a small ground of lentils, forget it. You know what? I don't care how small we view it in our eyes. Defend the truth. Defend what the Bible says. As small as it may seem in your eye, defend it. So we have everybody else running away, and we have one individual standing in this patch of beans that considers it as a gift of God and a help from God, and he's not letting it go. He's not letting it be taken by anybody. He's not letting anybody whatsoever do take what God had given. Verse 12, but he stood in the midst or the middle of the ground and defended it and slew the Philistines, and the Lord wrought great victory. See, the reason that Shama was able to do this is he was dependent on God. Because it didn't say Shama won a great victory, it said the Lord wrought a great victory. But it happened because Shiloh was willing to stand. He's willing to say, hey, this patch of beans may not be much, but it's my God's patch of beans, and I'm going to stand and I'm going to defend it, even to my life. Now, we all think we'll do it. But you know what? Life's pretty precious. And when it comes down to it, I'll say this for sure, without the strength and the leadership of God, you will cave in. Depending on this flesh and depending on this mind, which is an extension of flesh, you'll give in. You're looking down the wrong end of the double barrel shotgun, you'll do things you didn't think you would do. And so we find we can criticize the majority of this little band of soldiers, but I do want you to see that they're the majority. And Shimna was the different one. He was the one that stood when no one else would, and it ought to be our desire to be like him. Now, go with me to the New Testament, the book of Acts, chapter 6. Acts chapter 6, we're going to read of another individual that always showed himself strong, even in the New Testament. You know, you're like, well, Brother Larry, that's in the Old Testament. Well, it spills over to the New Testament time and time and time again that we should continue on. Acts chapter 6, and we're going to just read verse 5. Now, if you know your Bible, you know that they had just decided to ordain some deacons. And Stephen was selected. Verse 5. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. Now, I'm going to stop off reading there and find his two qualifiers. It says he was full of faith. And I point out what it didn't say. It didn't say the faith. The faith is the oracles of truth handed down to God's people. Faith is just belief and confidence. And you know what I see among Sovereign Grace Baptists? They have the faith, but they don't have faith. They have the truth, but they don't have confidence in the one that gave it to us. So we find that Stephen had faith. If God said it, he meant it. If God said, go and do it, well, I have a confidence in God that I'll go and I'll get the job done. It was faith. It was believing faith. And it says that he was full of faith. And then the other element that he possessed, the other thing that made him different, full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. That's that word Baptists don't like to discuss very often. But full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. Now, I understand that the Holy Ghost abides with His people, but at the same time, and if you'll be honest with me, you have had times in your life that the Spirit was far from you because of sin in your life. And if that's not the case, then you don't understand David. You don't understand Paul. So I'm not saying a fresh filling, but I am saying this, not all of us are filled with the Holy Ghost. Because when we're filled with Him, when He's the leading factor, we'll follow Him. And anything less is rebellion, right? We're not following. So Stephen had these two qualities, and he continued with them all the days of his life, full of faith, full in confidence, and full of the Holy Ghost. In other words, he was in such a situation in his closeness to God, he was always in tune with that Holy Ghost. He was always in tune with what he was being led to do, and he always, always followed through. Now, last thing I'll point out to him, what was his job? Initially, what was his job? To serve tables, right? Now, that's one thing I've never done except for my children. I'm sure I wouldn't have been the waiter that got the big tip because I don't have very much patience. But you know what? This man that was full of faith and Holy Ghost, he didn't think he was too good to do it, did he? In fact, he treasured it. If I can do this, man, I'm going to do it with everything I have. If I can wait tables for God's people, I'm going to get in there and I'm going to wait them. And I'll say, you want some more coffee? Can I bring you some more juice? Do you want an extra helping? I'm going to do it with everything I have. See, that's where we need to be. That is the true mark of someone who has confidence in the person of Christ. It no matter how meager it may seem to man, no, just like that little ground of lentils, no matter how small it may seem to mankind, I'm going to give it 150% because God had put me there. Drop down to 8. Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. You see that his ministry is advancing. Now, just don't think that only preachers have a ministry. Every one of us have a ministry. And if you're faithful to something small, he's going to enlarge it. So he went from waiting tables, and we find him just a short time later, we still have that wonderful character, that wonderful thing that marked him, full of faith and full of power. Power is when you tell someone how it is, even when it offends them. And we'll find that ultimately that's how he gave his life. But see, he had power in what he said. He had strength. He had confidence. Full of faith and power, and did great wonders and miracles among the people. And we won't get too far into that this morning. I understand that the first century church had some unusual things they could do. But I also say this, never does it say Stephen was an apostle. He was never elected to that office. And so we see then that he was willing to yield himself to the use of the Lord no matter what the circumstance. Acts 7, verse 51. This is where that type of faith will take you. This is where that type of power, that dependence on God, that confidence in His ability. Listen, it don't put you on a billboard, and it don't put you in there with Jack Van Impe, and it won't put you on a TV network, but it will put you in this place right here. Acts 7, verse 51, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. Why do you always resist the Holy Ghost? As your fathers did, so do ye. Now, that's a sermon that takes hide, hair, coming and going. That's the kind of man Stephen was. Now, I will say in that Eden study this week, he said, as your fathers did, meaning the old nation of Israel, meaning before Christ came. He says, you resist the Holy Ghost. So when the Spirit led them, and you know that to be true, they wouldn't go the way of God. They resisted it. Even way back in the beginning, remember Lot? What was Lot's request? He said, don't make me go that way. Give me another option. Is that not resisting the Holy Ghost? You can kind of think what you want to about those two men that came to visit Lot in the day of his deliverance. I personally think they were Christ and the Holy Ghost, because he bowed to them and was never corrected for that. If they were simply angelic beings, they would have been rebuked. And they, is that not saying, hey, I don't want to go into that city, let me go to the mountain. Or the opposite, I don't want to go to the mountain, let me go to the city. If the Holy Ghost told him, you need to go to that mountain, and saying, no, give me plan B. Is that not resisting the Holy Ghost? Sure it is. And so we find that has always been the case of man. Verse 52, which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted, and they have slain them which shewed before of the coming of the just one, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and the murderers? Now you can find in Isaiah and Ezekiel and Daniel that was just the case. They said, Christ is coming, the Lamb of God is near, He's on His way, and they paid for it with their lives. So he was again just simply telling them the truth. Verse 53, who have received the law, meaning the law of God, by the deposition of angels, and have not kept it. And when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. Now, a lot of people want to spiritualize this. I don't. When it said it cut him to the heart, it got him right here in the soul. You know, when truth is presented to you spiritually, you really have two choices. You can accept it, or you can reject it. Now, I'm not talking about salvation, but I am talking about truth. Mm-hmm. We can accept that there was a church set up by God, set up by the Lord Jesus Christ in His earthly ministry, and He promised it perpetualness. Or we can reject it and say that all we are simply reformationists. I'll go with the church. See, that he knew that truth and he stuck to it. He said, listen, this is how it is. And so he was very, very specific. And then when it says they gnashed on him with their teeth, you know what I believe that means? They bit him. They literally grabbed him and bit him. A lot of people say, well, they were just throwing things back in his face. Well, only problem with that theory is the Bible doesn't say that. Right? They gnashed on him with their teeth. Listen, I've preached in a lot of different places. Seen a lot of different things. And I've never been bit, but I've been pretty close. I believe I would have been bit a couple of times if it hadn't been socially inappropriate. You tell people the truth and they don't like it, and they're going to do some unbelievable things. You know what? One of the worst ones I've seen, and it's still this way today, is women that bob their hair off. You know why, first of all, why that's wrong? The Bible says it. And the second reason is this. Ladies, if you want hair like mine, it's not so much my hair is pretty. I know what my hair looks like. But this means I'm a man and that I'm in control. And that's what the rebellion is. Right? And I never quite understood. Maybe y'all can refresh me and get me all straightened out really much. Why is it okay for women to bob their hair off if I can't have mine down to here? What's the difference? Right? What's the difference? And so we see then that they hated what he said, but he still stood for it. They bit on him in reaction to the truth, but he did stand for it. Verse 55, but he, meaning Stephen, but he being full of the Holy Ghost, again, that word we sometimes like to avoid, but he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked steadfastly up into heaven and saw the glory of God. If you'll follow that in 1 Corinthians 11, that means Jesus Christ and Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. And they cried with a loud voice and stopped up their ears and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet whose name was Saul. Now, that's what serving God to the fullest will get you. That's what non-compromise will get you. That's what saying, this is the line, this is what the Word of God says, and I'm going to stick with it, and I'm going to stand with it, and I'm not going to stand with a bunch who don't. All those examples in our three mighty men, everybody left them. You know what? Let them go. Let them go. A lot of people says, when does the church stop being a church? Well, I'm not sure about this. But it ain't about numbers. I can tell you that. I think a church stops being a church when they give up the truth.
Yeah.
Whatever part of the truth they choose to throw aside, that's the part that when they get to that point, they're no longer a church. And so we see then that Stephen had great testimony. He stood by himself against a multitude of Israelites, of Jews. He stood all by himself. He stood to the end and he gave his life for it. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he said this, he fell asleep. Now, let me say this, and I've said it a million times before. When it says he fell asleep, I believe he fell asleep. I don't believe he got conked in the head with a rock and it knocked him out. See, because when we're in the will of God, we can sleep in Jesus. It can be so comfortable in the midst of adversity that we can go to sleep. When Peter was going to be beheaded the next morning, the angel came in to deliver him. What was Peter doing? Sleeping. When that ship was about to turn over, what was Jonah doing? He was sleeping in the belly of the ship, right? Pretty consistent, ain't it? And so, we as the Lord's people, if we stand to the faith, even when we're by ourselves, I believe that we'll have what the Bible says, the peace of God that passeth all understanding. I believe that that's what we'll have. And we need to strive for that. We need to be dependent on that, even when we stand alone. We live in an unusual generation, do we not? I see it every day at the school, and just after 3 years, I still stand marveled at what some of these people will say. And when I see that, I see this. One day I really could be standing alone. Really, really I could. And that just makes me pray, Lord, give me strength in that day. Because I certainly can't depend on myself, right?